Welcome to Hypnosis Today, the nation's first web TV talk show that explores the fascinating world of hypnotherapy. My name is Lisa Mackenberg, and I'll be your host, covering a wide variety of subjects to help you understand the power of the subconscious mind and how hypnosis is being used today to help people achieve success, happiness, and prosperity. It is my pleasure to introduce my first two guests. Well, my first guest is Mary Sargent. Now, Mary is an honors grad of HMI College of Hypnotherapy. She is also an instructor at the Emerging Leaders Academy through the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department. And she has with her her very special guest, Rayvon. Now, Rayvon is joining us after spending 8 years in prison. And he came to visit Mary for hypnotherapy to turn his life around. Please help me welcome my guests. Rayvon, first I want to welcome you. I want to ask you a couple of questions. Why hypnotherapy to turn your life around?
Well, first of all, I've tried many of things to change my life. However, through Emerging Leaders, I learned to not use the word change, but yet transform. And so in my walk to transform my life, I became open to new possibilities. And hypnotherapy was available, and thus a possibility that I sought to try out to see.
Can you tell me a little bit about the program Emerging Leaders?
Well, Emerging Leaders is, there's no words for Emerging Leaders, actually. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful program where they help you explore yourself, where it is that you come from, and why is it that we continue to do the same things and get the same result, but yet won't change our approach.
What was it that was leading you in the direction that led to 8 years in prison? Was that the first time you were in prison? Were there other
things?
No, I've been
incarcerated numerous times. And again, you know, Emerging Leaders was key in, you know, just allowing me to see why it was that I continued the behavior that I knew ultimately would, you know, keep me incarcerated time and time again.
Yes.
But yet, I didn't change it.
Got it. Now, how would hypnotherapy, Mary, help someone who is stuck in a pattern, we call it a habit loop, of bad choices that lead to a life that someone doesn't want? How would you use hypnotherapy for someone who's in this pattern who wants to change his or her life?
Well, one of the things that we do is I desensitize not just Rayvon, but everyone to the triggers in their environment. Anger, you know, anger gets triggered very easily by a variety of situations and circumstances. So I do a lot of desensitization. And the other thing that I do a lot of is having them visualize in hypnosis being the person that they want to be. Because when you are a lifetime criminal, that started when you're very young, it's very hard to imagine being somebody completely different. So in hypnosis, with all of that critical mind out of the way, can visualize that.
What was going on in your environment that you needed to be desensitized to? So, you know, you had to change. The environment wasn't going to change. Is that right?
Exactly.
So what was going on in your environment that you had to desensitize to?
A lot of violence, a lot of self-hate, you know, and just negativity that had become attractive to me over years and years of being exposed to it. Mm-hmm. And just not, you know, not being able to see anything different.
You know, Mary also described desensitizing people to anger. Did you have anger?
Yes.
What were you so angry about?
What wasn't I angry about should be the question.
Yeah.
I was angry about everything. That was how, in the environment that I grew up, that's what I used to fuel me to survive. I attributed all emotions to anger. Sadness, you know, happiness, it all was in direct relation to anger. That was my fuel.
Well, you know, Mary said being able to make a picture of who you want to become. What does that picture look like for you?
Now the picture is it's open-ended possibility. Open-ended possibility. That's the only way that I can explain it. Whatever it is that I want, I know that I know that I know that it's available for me.
Yes.
Because through the sessions with Mary, we were able to clear away the things that I were holding on to in my past that was keeping my sights set there in my past and yet not in my future.
Yeah. Now, you know, I think that if you had rocket fuel, it'd be a hard thing to get to give up. And you were using anger as rocket fuel. So what do you have to substitute with so you still have that motivation to replace the anger, to push you forward?
Well, my anger is not replaced, yet it is channeled as it should be. I still get angry. Mm-hmm. However, I don't use it to fuel me. I don't hold on to it to fuel me as a grudge. It's an emotion that I allow to pass through. You know, I experience anger and I allow it to pass through. Now my motivation is just knowing that, you know, there's possibilities for whatever. You know, whatever I set my sights on, whatever I want to achieve in life, it's available to me, and I'm present to that fact at all times.
You know, this is kind of a weird question. I would think to be a criminal, you do have to have a certain amount of gifts. Would that be a fair statement? What are you going to use your gifts for now? And what were those gifts that allowed you to be a successful criminal?
I'm very observant. I have a very creative mind, you know, by happenstance. I don't know where it came from, but I have, you know, I am a creative thinker, and
ethics.
Yes.
Oh, Mary just said one thing. What do you have? A strong sense of
ethics.
What?
Ethics. Ethics, I do.
So being observant, being vigilant, which is something I want to talk to you about, being very observant, and creative. How are you going to use those talents now for something different?
I've been using them in a different manner, really to reach out to those who, you know, who walk that same walk that I walk, in order to, you know, reach out and touch them, whereas their minds and their ears will be closed to anyone but someone who has actually taken that walk.
I think that is brilliant, because you have the credibility that someone who's not been in that experience, that one person can't have. So Mary, tell me how you use hypnotherapy with someone who wants to change his life around, so he or she can take all those talents and bring them into a way to be able to nurture and nourish and heal themselves and heal the world.
Well, I reinforce everything that we do in the class. That's a very important thing. And I do find, like I just whispered to him about his strong sense of ethics, he does have that, and he is his word. So we reinforce that in hypnosis. And in reinforcing that, it actually becomes part of this new way of being.
You know, I'm going to go back to something that Rayvon said about being observant. Mm-hmm. Is that part of someone's suggestibility in hypnosis? Tell me about working with a population that wants to turn the life around.
Well, yes, because when people are hypervigilant, and that usually starts very, very young, because there's violence in the home, drug use, alcohol use, that hypervigilance creates somnambulism. So almost every single person I work with at ELA is a somnambulist. That means they take in both literal and inferential information equally. And that's a great thing, because they can do anything they want. They understand everything, but they also become completely overloaded. And it's very easy to hypnotize someone who's a somnambulist. They go in quite easily, and they will go quite deep.
But here I have to go to you. When you went to this program and you met, hi, I'm Mary, I'm the hypnotherapist in the group, what did you think about hypnosis? What did you think about hypnosis and what it meant for you, and if you were even able to be hypnotized? Tell me about what your very first impression was.
My very first impression was jive, like, you know, bull. I've never believed in being hypnotized or, you know, I thought it was something that was a battle of the wills. If you allowed yourself to be and you were weak-willed in that manner, then yes, you could be hypnotized. But otherwise, I didn't see it happening.
Were you surprised that those very things that let you believe that you couldn't be hypnotized are the very attributes that have you be open to suggestions? And you thought it was jive, you thought it was bull, you thought it was a battle of the wills. What do you think right now, after you've experienced it?
I recommend it. I mean, if there's issues in your life that you really want to get to the core of, really address, I recommend it. I recommend it highly.
What did it feel like for you? Did it feel like a battle of the wills?
Actually, it was initially, I believe. However, there was something else that made me open to the possibilities of being hypnotized.
What was that?
And it was a handwriting analysis.
Really?
Yes.
Who did it? Did you do that, Mary?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to ask you. I'm going to ask Rayvon. Are you comfortable sharing with us what was revealed in your handwriting, which is a complete subconscious manifestation?
It was everything that I knew to be true about myself, and then some things that I didn't want to admit about myself.
But you knew were true.
Yes.
And did that open you to Mary?
Yes, undoubtedly. Mm-hmm. Undoubtedly.
What was the experience of hypnosis like? What did it actually feel like for you?
Initially, it was just a question and answer segment, it seemed like. And then from there, we went into soft tone speak, and the rest is history.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I found out a lot about me. I was able to accept a lot about me that, had it not come through hypnotherapy and the handwriting analysis, I've been rejecting it.
That's right, but it went in on a deeper level. You know, Mary, I know that you wish that you could go with every single one of your clients every place and keep your clients in hypnosis when there is stress. Have you ever taught any of your clients about what they can do in a full waking state to access calm, desensitized from anger and triggers in the environment?
Yes, I give them anchors.
What kind of an anchor? Can you teach us one?
Well, I do different anchors, but one of the things that's been really interesting to me in working with this population is a lot of times that they are most motivated when they are in prison. So by going into that place, accessing that state, all the good parts of that state, it's really, really powerful, and by anchoring it, they have access to it at all times.
That seems paradoxical. Were you most motivated when you were in prison to change your life?
Yes, I was. Prior to being released, I did have plans. I was, you know, studying and reading a lot of self-help books. However, being a repeat offender, I'll tell you, this last time I was incarcerated was maybe the first time that I really stepped out of my comfort zone and said that, you know, it was time for a change. However, I came home and I attempted the same exact activity.
Yes.
It begins in prison. ELA, the hypnotherapy, I believe, if it was brought, you know, to the inmate population prior to being released, it'll be more effective. It'll be because once our feet touch the ground, so to speak, our old lifestyles, our old friends, our old way of being and thinking is the most dominant picture in the forefront of our mind. And if you enjoyed any prosperity from that lifestyle, coming home to nothing, it'll be, you know, what you seek first. It'll be what you seek first every time, time and time again.
That's very, very insightful. Now, Mary, I know that everybody's going to want to learn more about working with people who want to change their lives around. And you can reach Mary Sargent on hmigrads.com. Well, I want to thank my guests, Mary and Rayvon. But we're going to take a short break. But please stay tuned, because when we come back, we're going to meet another HMI grad and her client who came to hypnotherapy to just lighten up. Stay tuned. We have a lot more coming up for you on Hypnosis Today.